Thank you very much. Yeah, you can hear me. So yeah, many of you have been to Barcelona, so you know maybe Barcelona better than me. So let me just say first, before I start my presentation, I'm really, really excited to be here. Because I think that actually democratizing technology, innovation, and the economy, and giving back power in the digital age to citizens, it's something that we have to do together. It is really a big goal that we have, and we do have to build a movement, and we have to build alliances that are unexpected. So we need cities, we need societal and political movements, we need technologists, we need governments that are progressive enough to understand that this is a big battle to gain back sovereignty, and we need to do it together. So for me, it is an honor to be able to tell you what we're doing in Barcelona to move in this direction. And let me also maybe start from why cities, because it's not obvious what can cities do in this space. And I think that contrary to some of the things we're seeing, some positions, some governments are increasing, you know, surveillance. Some of the laws that we see around, despite the very good data protection legislations that we have, are actually going in the direction of saying as a population that we are losing the war when it comes to privacy, because mass surveillance is cheaper and many governments are doing it. And because of anti-terror law, and we've just been hit, as you know, in Barcelona by very bad attack, but governments are using that to push back our freedoms. And this is really, I'm convinced that we cannot get liberties and freedom as a service. This is not just a technology issue, this is a political issue. It affects our economy, our society, our democracy. And so we really have to take it as a more holistic way. And cities, I think, can be seen as custodians, as new intermediaries that can be there in order to respect and make possible these new rights for citizens. And I think we can achieve that together. And also cities have to work in a network. So I'm gonna just tell you about what we are doing. And this is the Barcelona. Let me start from a little bit like a broader view. We have a Barcelona digital city roadmap that we built together with citizens, actually in a participatory democracy process. And we are basically doing digital transformation where we talk about, we are rethinking the smart city approach from the ground up. And we are building a progressive data strategy that I'm gonna actually focus in this presentation. We are doing digital innovation because on top of urban technology and cities infrastructure, we have to be able to attract talent and build services and new applications together with startups and social enterprises and citizens themselves. And then finally, we have a digital empowerment strategy because we really need to change culture, education, and rethink labor as well and work in the automation and the robot economy. So it's a comprehensive strategy, and you can go on our website and check it out if you're interested. When I started, my mayor, Ada Colau, called me more than a year ago to come to Barcelona to rethink the smart city. And we wanted to rethink the smart city, changing completely the paradigm, not thinking first about technology and data and connectivity, and then privatizing that in the hands of few multinational corporations, but actually start from the citizens first. What are their needs and the goal of the city? So we have to start from our missions, for instance, affordable housing, better energy policies, better mobility, energy transition, reducing CO2 emission, all these big cities' mission, and then think what kind of technology do we need, how it is designed, what is the governance, and then deploy these technologies to help solve some of these problems. So we really shifted the smart city agenda. And we understood that smart city, of course, is not just top-down services coming from few companies, and that cities have to move away from the lock-in problem that we have, legacy systems that don't allow us to be flexible, agile, and open. So moving into open architecture, open sourcing the smart city, and integrating a lot of the bottom-up innovation and technologies that are coming from citizens and entrepreneurs like you are. So we have an agile digital transformation strategy. Actually, this month, we will share a lot of the documentation that we are producing, which really moves to ethics, open source, open infrastructure, and citizen first, and really like citizen democracy. And why I talk about this is that, first of all, there is the data strategy is part of that. And second, it is really important the leverage that cities have when we talk about public procurement. You can do a lot to get also big companies to work based on the laws and strategy that the city mandates. For instance, how do we have privacy and security by design to in the tenders, in the public tenders? How do we make sure in the public tenders that when we are paying with citizen money the services that we commission to third parties, that the data belong to the citizens? And that has to be part of the way we write the tenders, so that the data can be released in open source, but also that privacy-aware technologies can be used by third parties, and that there is this ownership of citizen data in the way we make public tenders. So this is a big part, I think, of what we can do also to influence more the business on how they should run innovation in a more ethical way. Digital transformation also starts with data. I mean, this we know, we now have, 90% of the data that currently exists now, it didn't exist 3 years ago. I mean, this is a real revolution. And knowledge now is closed in silos. I mean, in particular in public administration, it's really siloed. We don't have a unified, we don't have control, actually, of our data. We lost control of our data, majority with our provider, while knowledge is distributed and not centralized. And it's really important to understand that this data infrastructure and data as a public resource is fundamental for us to solve a lot of the city problems. Without, we are basically dead. Data is the new oil, and many of you hate this expression, and I'm with you because data is actually not oil, it's a very different asset. But what I say here is we have a big power asymmetry in the digital economy. And if you see here, these are the largest companies by market capitalization, 2016. They're all US-based technology firms, and only few years before, it was all companies and big retailers, but there was only Microsoft there. So we see that there is a big change in how the economy is run. And actually, I don't know if you are familiar with Shoshana Zuboff. She works in Harvard Business School. And she talks about surveillance capitalism as the new economy of the internet, because this is also commercial surveillance. It's not just surveillance that states do to control you, but actually these companies really, we are using a lot of services for free, but we know that we are paying this with our data. And our data is used now with deep learning, machine learning, artificial intelligence services in order to rethink the future of our economy and our society. So this is a bit predatory, very few companies here, and we have to find, I think, a European and different model for our economy that's more democratic and more fair. So I think you should be with me when I say that Europe really have to step forward with a different model and gain back the technological sovereignty that we seem to be losing. The other, of course, important part is how do we use data for decision making? It is really important not only because we want more evidence-based decision making, but it is really difficult to take big decisions and change services in the city if we don't have the right data. And I think here politics is losing the game, really. And actually, only now that we have a lot of cybersecurity and security issues, politicians are waking up understanding the power of data and technology in our society. But they should not just do it because of surveillance and cyber attacks and security problem, but because we really have to catch up in order to determine in what society we want to live in. So we want to have data sovereignty, and this is the big goal. And maybe affirm a new deal on data, which are new social and collective rights that citizens should have in the digital world, in the digital era. So that's why we're putting forward a comprehensive data strategy, which has transparency, privacy, security, and ethical use of data for innovation at its core. So we want to have ethics and data innovation, data sovereignty, security, and privacy by design, a data infrastructure at city scale, of course, with open standards and single API strategy, which, I mean, you'll be discussing in lots of the workshops here, and then accountable technology. So the problem now with algorithmic transparency of this big platform monopolies is really a problem. How can I regulate something if I'm a city, if I can't look inside inside the black box. If it's a black box and I don't have transparency of the algorithms, I don't know how it affects prices in the city, service, how people are discriminated, and so on. So it creates a lot of problems. New ownership regime of data. It's finally time that we as policymakers are very clear. Citizens own the data. Citizens control the data. It's your data. You're co-producing together with us. And cities can be custodians of new rights. So here you can see, like, we have a framework in Barcelona, which is really complex to get. Barcelona is a data-driven city, which has city data commons at its core, because we have multiple agencies which have a lot of data and don't communicate with each other. We are now building interoperable infrastructures like Sentillo and CityOS. I will talk in a moment. We have a platform that does democracy, and Decode, which is an experimental project which with distributed ledgers and cryptography to also get personal data and trust from people. And until now, cities mainly deal with city data without thinking about personal data and without thinking about private data. And now everything is coming there. And if we manage to get this right, then we can have a common platform on top of which entrepreneurs, cities, and social entrepreneurs, startups can build new applications and services based on fair rules and a better business model. And that's where we want to get. Now, data, it's an infrastructure, yes. And in the city, this is very clear because we run smart city infrastructure. So it's about, you know, water, transport, sanitation, like a lot of things run on a layer of data, which is very integrated with the urban infrastructure. And in the city hall, it's not right. It's locked in departments, we have no governance model, people don't talk to each other. So we have to get to a point, and that's why we built CityOS. Everything is actually open standards. Since I went to Barcelona, I really had this as a mission. We want to work as much as possible with open source, with open hardware, with open standards-based solution, in order to get integration of all these different data and privacy at its core, which was the hard thing to do, because we are not used to really say that cryptography is a human right, and people have the right to cryptography, because only in that way they can really feel in control of their data. So this is what we're building in Barcelona to make sure that we have some horizontal data lake in the city. We also have Sentillo, which is an open sensor platform. It's all open specification. You can actually take it and reuse it. Has now been used actually across the world. And we are using it for energy monitoring, noise, water. We also have an urban lab where we ask small company to test their solution and then go to public procurement, garbage collection, parking spot, and all of that. And on top of this architecture, like Sentillo and CityOS, we want to build city data commons. And that's why we are like now experimenting with pilots, because someone also before told me, yes, it's great, you have strategy, you have directives, you have regulation on procurement, but we want to see real projects, we want to do pilots from the ground up. And that's the approach we are taking. And this is some of the pilots on affordable housing. We're building a city data analytic office based on the data commons and urban planning projects. So of course the open data portal, I think all cities now have it, we are expanding that and enlarging that, and also trying to get more companies to work with us in opening up the data, and that's the difficult part. We are opening we have a participatory and open budget that we're also using not only for transparency and against corruption, which is a big and important thing in public administration, but also to get citizens to participate in allocating resources, like a participatory budgeting project that we're running in Barcelona. I think we are one of the few cities, if not the only city in the world, which has an encrypted infrastructure it's based on Tor, and is basically favoring whistleblowers inside the administration to denounce these cases of corruption. It's called Bustia Ethica, and it's integrated with the architecture of the city. So we are incentivating everybody inside the city hall or outside the city hall to denounce cases of corruption using this encrypted infrastructure. We are very proud of our digital democracy platform, which is called Decidim Barcelona. More than 40,000 people participated in building the roadmap of the government. And right now, we're acting on a much more democratic, I think, roadmap where people could prioritize proposal, they could debate proposal. And we are now running seven participatory process in parallel. This is also open source, and it's you can audit the code, and it's open standards. And now we are even like integrating more privacy-aware solutions in the technology. And so now we are running a participatory process on culture, urban planning, participatory budgeting, mobility, and collaborative legislation processes. This is the code. I actually presented it before in a workshop that we had. It's one of the most experimental projects that we're running, and is decentralized citizen-owned data ecosystem. That's really where we're trying to integrate the personal data inside the entire infrastructure. And we are working with attribute-based encryption and distributed ledger technology. And in particular, we are trying to make a lot of awareness and gain citizen trust that actually there is a different way that people can not only protect their personal information, but also donate them as a common with a particular licensing and with technologies that protect their rights. And well, this is work in progress, decodeproject.eu, and we're going to release a technical architecture. So we think this is a project where we are really with this community very much aligned. And Decode is part of a broader effort of the European Commission, which is about creating next-generation platforms. And the European Commission has invested too little, I think. I think that Europe should have a much bigger effort in regaining digital sovereignty. And I think that all of you here should lobby from the bottom up. It should be really a citizen lobby to get this kind of technologies out there, because we need this infrastructure for society and for the economy. And as a city, I just want to add, we need alternative collaborative platforms. We do need next-generation collaborative platforms that are not predatory, like Airbnb and Uber, and we can do it in our cities. I mean, we are now starting to talk between, for instance, Barcelona, New York, Berlin, Amsterdam, on what are these next-generation collaborative economy platforms, can be on as cooperatives, can be having mixed models of ownership, but underlying this kind of new technologies, there is robust, privacy-aware, secure, decentralized and encrypted infrastructure for owning and managing data. And I think this is critical, because otherwise we will remain with this kind of monopolies, and it's very hard to move away from that. And of course, this is creating a lot of impact in our the way that we run our services. I don't hide it that in Barcelona, we're taking a pretty confrontational approach with companies like Uber or Airbnb. But the fact is, yes, I'm totally for asking more algorithmic transparency, maybe asking this company to release more of their data, but also we need alternatives, and we need to build these alternatives together. So yeah, finally, the Mayor's Office for Data Analytics. This is what we're building also to really try to support better decision making, to create data teams in the city hall that have the skills of doing analytics and you know, machine learning. And we're working together with, of course, research centers, the Barcelona Supercomputing Center, which is really, really good at doing deep learning and machine learning, or Eurocat and all of that. But we are now creating a team inside the city hall, and actually Barcelona is nominating a chief data officer. Some city have it, we didn't have it before, just to show that we're really serious about going forward with this agenda. And data and algorithmic transparency is something we can, of course, have advocacy at city level, but we need to do something at national level, at European level, and even the Chancellor of Germany recently said it to these big companies, we do need to see what's inside the algorithms and the black box. And then, of course, we can run open data challenges and open data commons challenges. We are putting money that comes from the development funds together with public innovation, public procurement, in order to we are putting 10 million now out for SMEs and small companies to work with the city administration and build challenges in order to tackle our main problems in housing, education, and energy. And finally, I mean, I invite you, Barcelona is becoming a hub for Industry 4.0, Internet of Things. I mean, we're hosting many of these events where we can gather and strategize together. We're going to host the Smart City Expo, where we're really trying to work together with cities and all of you. So you're welcome to join any of this. Finally, this is my last point because I'm running late. Culture, leadership, and education is really key. So this is something that also you're stressing a lot. If we don't align organization, the data management and data infrastructure, everything has to be aligned. It's a radical shift in the mindset of public administration today. If you haven't worked inside, you don't even know how big is the challenge and the gap. So not only there is a trust gap, before it was said, but there is also a culture gap. So we need to build capabilities, we need to create awareness inside and outside administration, and I think communities like yours are really helpful to do that. So this is our website, and hopefully this is just the beginning of a conversation on how to make this stronger and real, and how to network, first of all as cities, but then with movements like yours and technologies, and make it happen. Thank you.